Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that is God's word to us in our language. Let's start today with Psalm 91. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked, because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Those who love me I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life I will satisfy them and show them my salvation. Those are God's words from Psalm 91. Our musical guest today is Rich Mullins.
Sometimes my life just don't make sense at all. When the mountains look so big, oh, my faith just seems so small. So hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been king of my glory. Won't you be my prince of peace? And I wake up in the night and feel the dark. It's so hard inside my soul. I swear there must be blisters on my heart. So hold me, Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been king of my glory. Won't you be my prince? So many walls, now I'm falling down, I'm falling on my knees. And the Salvation Army band is playing this hymn. And your grace rings out so deep, it makes my resistance seem so thin.
That's been Rich Mullins. We'll hear from Rich Mullins again at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to Mark's Gospel, chapter 9, verses 14 through 29. When they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and some scribes arguing with them. When the whole crowd saw Jesus, they were immediately overcome with awe, and they ran forward to greet him. He asked them, "What are you arguing about with them?" Someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak, and whenever it seizes him, it dashes him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. And I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they could not do so." He answered them, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be among you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him to me." And they brought the boy to him. When the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. It has often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out, "I believe, help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." After crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he was able to stand. When he had entered the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" He said to them, "This kind can come out only through prayer." Those are God's words from Mark chapter 9, verses 14 through 29. Angie and William were discussing school, and they both agreed that recess was the best class. They also both agreed that playing soccer was really fun, and they both thought that the pizza burgers tasted kind of funny. And then Angie said, "William, you know church is a lot like math class." William responded, "Math class? I do not see how church is like math at all." Angie said in her best fourth grade wisdom, "Well, it all comes down to math. Our Lord Jesus Christ adds and multiplies, while Satan just subtracts and divides." In our passage for today, which is recorded in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, we see a dad who brings his troubled son to meet Jesus. He goes through the disciples, but when they fail, he continues to strive to find healing for his son. The very interesting encounter is between Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, and a demon, the demon who was possessing a youth. As always, Jesus Christ, our Master and Messiah, is victorious, and the youth is healed. As we have been looking at the healing miracles of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, never forget that healing is dependent upon God's will and God's plan. Healing might happen in a miraculous manner, or healing may take place the more typical route and come through medicines, treatments, and therapies, or healing might not come at all. It is all dependent on God and what God desires. As we read in Philippians 4, verse 6, "Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." And as Jesus tells us, as recorded in Luke chapter 11, 11 through 13, "Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" Our passage today takes place shortly after the great miracle of the Transfiguration. So while Jesus took Peter, James, and John up to the mountain, the other disciples have been down in the valley, and they've been failing in their ministry. As Jesus, Peter, James, and John return from the mountain, they come upon a quarrel. There's a big crowd, and the disciples and scribes are arguing back and forth. Jesus asks, "What are you arguing about?" Then a man comes and falls at Jesus' feet. The man tells Jesus about his son. Now Luke's gospel tells us that this was the man's only child, and the son is in a terrible state. The son is possessed by a demon. The symptoms of this possession mimic epilepsy. The boy is unable to speak. He is struck by seizures. He foams at the mouth, and he's often fallen into water or into fire. Yes, the boy is in a terrible state, and it is all caused by the demon, for the boy is possessed. Demonic possession is a real fact. I have seen it. Now, there are two incorrect philosophies regarding demonic possession. One erroneous concept is that all illness and mental health problems are somehow caused by demons. That's wrong. And the other incorrect concept, one which seems to be more widespread today, is to say, well, to deny that demons are real, or to claim that demonic possession is just somehow a myth or legend. Well, there are even some theologians who will propose that the references to demonic possession in God's Word are just like metaphors or illustrations, but that view is wrong. The Bible is trustworthy and sufficient, and in the Bible there are a multitude of references to demons as real things. Yes, demons are real evil entities, and demonic possession is a really serious but somewhat rare occurrence. What is not so rare is what happened with the disciples. They got in an argument. They've been arguing with the scribes, and they've not been helping the youngster who really needed them, the man who was demonically possessed. Now, we are not sure exactly what the argument was all about, but often the Bible tells us that the disciples were quarreling about who was the greatest among them. I can just see that the disciples were fighting for their own pride, power, and status while the young boy suffered, and the corrupt scribes were snickering from the sidelines. Yes, that was quite a mess when Jesus came down from the mountain. And the dad has brought his afflicted son to the disciples, but they failed to help. And then he appeals directly to Jesus Christ. The dad says to Jesus, "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus then says, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be among you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring him to me." Can you hear the sorrow in Jesus' words as he sees the problem? The disciples, the scribes, and the crowds have been arguing and fighting, but they failed to help the needy boy. Jesus still loves the boy and asks that he be brought. The dad brings the possessed youth, and suddenly the demonic manifestations begin. The demon recognizes Jesus Christ as God in the flesh, and then it attacks the boy. The boy goes into a seizure, falling to the ground and foaming at the mouth. It was a gruesome sight. Jesus asks the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" You see, Jesus loves the dad and loves the afflicted boy. And the dad responds, "Since childhood." It is very difficult to say exactly when a demon will come and enter into a person. Oftentimes it happens due to willful sinning, but sometimes it happens to innocent people like this youth. So let's look for a moment at some of the avenues of attack that demons might use to influence people. Satan is at the head of an evil hierarchy of demons. They go by many names: evil spirits, unclean forces, demons, devils, principalities, powers, and spiritual forces of darkness. In John's Gospel, in chapter 8, verse 44, we learn that Satan has been a killer from the beginning, and as well as an accomplished liar. And this allows us to see a bit into what demons do. And demons can gain a foothold in a person's life through violence and killing. And one big lie of today is that killing can somehow be justified. I see this especially in evil video games that are marketed to children. There are a vast legion of video games where the so-called game consists of killing human images on screen. The killing is rewarded and encouraged by this so-called game. Children playing these things might very well open their spiritual lives to demonic forces and thereby undergo cruel suffering. For in Galatians 6, verse 7, we learn from God, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow." And this is not just limited to video games. Movies demonstrate horrible acts of violence over and over again. Some movies with big-name action heroes are just glorified slasher films, and the public pays money to witness someone murdered on screen. Then all the evil killing is trivialized. One action hero, for example, stabbed a man with a sword and pins him to the wall in a bloody mess, and then mockingly says, "Just stick around." And in real life, this was seen just recently, too, in the demonically inspired murder of Matthew Shepard. A violent murder which some people, some hypocrites, have tried to excuse and justify due to Matthew Shepard's sinning. Well, the demons just laugh and infect more people. So when we as a society have been sowing killing, violence, and evil to people, even little children in their minds, why are we surprised when children end up violent, maybe killing others or even killing themselves? And violence is not the only mode demons use to attack people. The dangers are vast. Anything that's sin, demons are there. Pornography, illegal drugs, alcohol abuse, tobacco abuse, all have their own legions of demons lurking in the spiritual nooks and crannies, just waiting to torment an unsuspecting victim. And even the Halloween event might allow demons to attack people. Historically, Halloween is an evil day whose roots are in black magic and Satanism. Many people might say something like, "Oh, it's just a costume party, and it's all fun and games." But the demons do not care if you believe it's all fun and games. The demons will seek to use any excuse to get to you, and they take that very seriously. Preconceived notions cannot really change the truth. For example, if you come up on a barrel of some unknown substance, and you might say to yourself, "Oh, it's just filled with spring water." Then when you reach inside the barrel and discover it's filled with acid, would your previous concepts and ideas really matter? Would they? For the truth is that the acid would still burn you. You cannot change reality by altering truth or by wishful thinking. It's similar with demonic forces. To underestimate their danger is to really ask for trouble. You might be tempted to say, "Well, there really are no demons." But if you do not believe in demons, just try working for Jesus Christ for a while. Then you'll know that demons exist. For when you start to do great things in service to Jesus Christ, the demons will respond. But the Father in our story knows the truth. This dad recognizes that even though the disciples have failed miserably, Jesus Christ can still help. The dad brings his son before Jesus and says to Jesus, "If you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us." Jesus responds with a question, "If you are able?" Then the dad utters a beautiful and really honest prayer. He turns to Jesus and says, "I believe, help me in my unbelief." Yes, even in the midst of the disciples' failure and some unknowns and uncertainties, this dad recognizes that Jesus is the help and the only true hope. This still happens today for those people who are willing to see the truth. Boris was a hard-working man who had the habit of working late. He came home and learned that yet again, his teenage son Michael was not home. Boris said he'd wait up to see Michael. Well, several hours passed, and Michael came home and he was drunk. Boris was enraged. He grabbed his son and pushed him out of the house and yelled at him, "Don't you ever come into my house again!" As Boris sat back down to contemplate his situation, he began to think back to all the things he'd done when he'd overworked and been absent from his family. He realized that perhaps his son's problems were partially his responsibility. Boris said to himself, "Well, I might be to blame for that boy's conduct. After all, I've yelled at him way too many times, and I've been far too harsh on him, and I've even been mean toward him. I have failed to show him my love. And how can that boy know Jesus' love if I've never shown it to him?" As a result of his reflections, Boris put on his coat and started out to find his son. He stopped at each place that served liquor and asked, "Have you seen my son?" showing them a picture. One by one, the people said no, but Boris kept searching. Finally, he found his son as he was entering a bar. Boris came up to his son and said, "Oh, my dear boy, will you please forgive me? I have failed to show you love and to help you. I have never demonstrated to you how to live, and I apologize to you. Please forgive me and give me another chance." The son Michael was touched. His heart poured out to his dad, and right there in the street they hugged. Together they asked Jesus Christ to forgive them and to assist them in their lives. Each of them committed his life to Jesus Christ as personal Savior and Lord. Then they really knew love, and that was the last night that Michael ever drank alcohol. Today, they are both living solid, happy, wonderful lives following Jesus Christ. And in our passage, Jesus heals the dad's son. Jesus shows love and casts out the demon. Jesus addresses the demon and commands, "You spirit, I command you to come out of him and never enter him again." Immediately, the evil spirit shakes the boy and departs. The evil spirit is banished. The demon is cast out. Jesus heals the boy spiritually, but the boy has suffered greatly. The boy looks dead. Jesus continues to heal and takes him by the hand and lifts him up, and he is cured. The boy is healed. The boy is whole again. The demon is gone, and so are all the horrible symptoms. And this dad discovered that by appealing to Jesus Christ and asking Christ to help, help even in your unbelief, he found healing. Jesus helps the dad overcome his concerns, and Jesus heals his son. This dad then discovered the truth as we know it from God's word. For in Hosea 10, verse 12, we read, "Sow for yourselves righteousness, reap steadfast love. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord, that he may come and rain righteousness upon you." And even though there were years of affliction with this man and his son, both learned that through Jesus' incredible love, great things can happen. In Romans 5, 1 through 5, we read, "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us." That's from Romans chapter 5. Yes, the dad in our story found true healing for his son. True healing comes only from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Now, the disciples wonder why they can't cast out this demon. After all, they've been successful previously in casting out demons. Well, the Bible does not tell us directly what the specific problem was, but we can suppose. They certainly didn't do the right thing. Perhaps they were too filled with self-pride, maybe too self-centered. They wanted to show off for the scribes in the crowds. They wanted to do it in their own spiritual power. They may have been using the boy as a way to increase their own prestige and status among the people. Well, whatever they were doing, it was wrong. And then Jesus addresses them and states it very simply. This kind can come out only by prayer. Yes, prayer is key. James 5:16 tells us, "Therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective." But sadly, the disciples did not recognize the power of confession and prayer at that time. Yes, prayer is very powerful. An old man was rather ill. His family called for the pastor to come and visit. So Pastor Leslie entered the room and commented, "Oh, Donald, I see that I am not the first visitor you have had today." The old man looked puzzled, but following the pastor's nod, he looked at the empty chair. "Oh, well, Pastor Leslie, I'll tell you about that chair. Many years ago, I found it quite difficult to pray. So one day I shared this with my former pastor. So Pastor Chris said that I should stop worrying and kneeling and trying to find the right position for prayer. Pastor Chris said, just sit down, pull up an empty chair, and imagine Jesus, our loving Lord and Savior, is sitting in the empty chair, and then just talk with him as you would with a good friend." The old man stopped for a moment and then added, "I've been doing that with an empty chair ever since." So Pastor Leslie stayed and sat with the old man for a while. Then Pastor Leslie sang him a song and prayed with him. A short time later, the daughter of the old man telephoned and spoke to Pastor Leslie. She said, "Oh, Pastor Leslie, my father has died. I had just checked on him and he was sleeping, so I'd gone to lie down for a bit of a nap, and when I came back to his room, he was dead." And then she added thoughtfully, "It was kind of odd. When I found Dad, he was lying with his head on that empty chair he always had near his bed. Isn't that strange?" Pastor Leslie responded, "Oh, no, that's not strange. That's not odd at all. I completely understand why he was that way with his head in the chair when he died." Jesus can heal you. Jesus can heal your physical problems. Jesus can heal your psychological problems. Jesus can heal your emotional problems. And Jesus can even cast out the demons and evil spirits who might be clinging to your life and making you miserable. Just trust in Jesus, for Jesus loves you. And as Christians, we need to believe in the essentials of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. I believe that He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the worldwide Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. So if you're struggling with a problem, turn to your pastor, minister, or priest and ask for Jesus to help. I'm John Thornton. Thanks very much for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and surround yourselves with Christian people, Holy Spirit-filled believers. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. Thanks again for your letters. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, God tells us through His wonderful Bible that love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So love Jesus Christ our Lord with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors, and even love your enemies as yourselves. We'll finish today with Rich Mullins.
And all the